Welcome back to Anastasi in Tech. According to a new report by McKinsey, computing demand will increase by a factor of at least 100 over the next 5 years. And chipmakers and semiconductor fabs are putting in a lot of effort to satisfy this demand. For semiconductors, this decade is all about vertical integration, stacking chiplets on top of each other and stacking transistors. And that's great for the performance, but very problematic for cooling. In this video, I will explain how different cooling technologies are keeping Moore's law alive. And the most interesting of all, I will explain some brand new transistor level cooling technology that will save the chips of the future from roasting in their own heat. This cooling technology is so cool that it has its own fan club. Current and future generation of chips have a fundamental problem. By now, we've managed to continuously improve the performance by packing more and more transistors into a size of a chocolate square. Right now, the smallest transistors are just 2 and 3 nanometers, allowing us to stuff massive 200 billion transistors into a tiny piece of silicon. But now there is a problem, because now there are so many transistors that they cannot be used all at once without the chip overheating. And how much heat a chip dissipates, measured in so-called TDPs, which stands for thermal design power. And it's actually based on the maximum heat flux that we can remove from this chip. If we take NVIDIA H100 GPU, it's about 700 watt TDP. And the latest NVIDIA Blackwell GPU dissipates about 1000 watt of heat. And one of the big problems here of such a chip, that while this chip operates, half of this area, half of the silicon, is actually dark silicon. Dark silicon is a phenomenon where a significant portion of the transistors on the chip cannot be computing at the same time due to power and thermal constraints. What makes it even worse is ongoing vertical integration, because the future of the chips is in stacking them on top of each other. It's all started by stacking chiplets, small pieces of silicon that have their own function, on top of each other. Back in 2022, AMD was the first to introduce V-cache technology, when they stacked an additional cache memory on top of a CPU die, and it's all acted as one single chip. And the same trend is happening with chips' building blocks, transistors. We are now at the pivotal moment in the history of transistors, where we simply aren't able to achieve more with just FinFET architecture. And now we are transitioning towards stacking nanosheets vertically. And according to iMac, by 2030, we will be stacking transistors on top of each other. Well, what are we gonna do with all this additional heat that is coming as a result of this? Just like the current heat wave in Europe, heat is very disruptive. What is heat? Heat is a waste product of semiconductor usage. When an electric field is applied to the transistor, electric current flows in the channel from the source to the drain. This results in conventional Joule heating due to the energy transfer from the electrons to the lattices. While the chip performs operations, transistors are switching from 1 to 0 and back, right? And the power is being dissipated in the transistor devices as well as in interconnect wires. And we have to get rid of this heat, because heat is ruthless to the transistors and to the chip, degrading its performance. Heat damages chips by accelerating the aging of components and decreasing their lifetime. It also causes components inside to thermally expand, which causes signal distortion and dysfunction. And the difficulty of removing the heat means that today's largest chips cannot use all their transistors at once, so as not to overheat. Typically, what we used to do is to conduct this heat out somewhere and then dissipate it. There are many ways to keep chips cool. By far, the most popular solution involves cooling with air or liquid. Cooling with air works for some desktop chips and some of the server processors, which dissipate about 280 watts. However, somewhere at around 300 watt TDP, we reach the limit of what we can cool with air alone. And above that, we must switch to liquid cooling, which can conduct up to 3,000 times more heat than air can. This works, for example, with NVIDIA GPUs like A100, which can dissipate up to 1,000 watts of heat. Now, air or liquid cooling is what we typically think of when we think of cooling. But in reality, things are much more interesting and much more complicated. More advanced GPUs like AMD's MI300 or H100 employ a mixture of cooling strategies. From my many years working in chip design, I can tell you that the work on cooling starts already during the physical design phase. Here, we have to keep in mind the switching activity of the blocks, because some of the blocks will be switching more than the others. Some portions of the design might be more computationally intensive, like a hardware accelerator, and this will create a hot spot on the die. And then we must place this block in a way that minimizes the peak temperature and also the gradient, temperature gradient across the chip. And here, EDA tools, electronic design automation tools, and power analysis tools are very helpful. But that's usually not enough. So for 3D chips, we have to create heat corridors by placing TSVs in a particular way to help to spread the heat evenly. So-called TSVs are through-silicon vias, which are copper connections that travel through silicon die. These are used to connect chiplets in designs like AMD MI300, which has 13 chiplets stacked together and acting as one big chip. And a similar technology is used in many other designs, for example, in Intel's Ponte Vecchio GPU. TSVs are great because overall you're able to gain in performance and latency. And of course, you're also gaining in cooling, because with TSVs we're providing both vertical and horizontal pathways for heat dissipation. But again, those are made of copper, which is 4 times less conductive than silicon. So they do help to guide some heat away, but it's not a silver bullet, unfortunately. And unfortunately, I happen to know that about 70 or even 75% of you watching this video are not subscribed to the channel. So could you please do me a favor and consider subscribing to the channel? This helps the channel more than you know, because the bigger the channel gets, the bigger the guests that I can interview for you get. Thank you. Eventually, we end up guiding as much heat as we can to heat sinks or cold plates. And some of the heat sinks have these bizarre fin shapes, because the goal here is to maximize the area of the contact. So when water is passing through these plates, we can maximize the area of what we can actually cool. And what's interesting, some of the companies like Fabric 8 Labs using generative AI for designing these fin shapes in the most efficient way. In any case, everything has its limits, so even heat sinks have their limits. So if we want to cool down something very hot, like dojo training tile, for example, which dissipates about 15,000 watts of heat, which is huge, we clearly need something more sophisticated and more advanced here. In the case of dojo, it's a whole new level, because here the cooling is integrated in the package. In one of my old deep dive videos on dojo, I discussed that they use TSMC's integrated fan-out wafer scale packaging technology. In this case, the cold plate is integrated right into the package, and it's placed right on top of the computing tiles, which generate all this massive amount of heat. And then many tiny pipes, so-called inlets and outlets, are going through the package, and then with water, the heat is being moved away through these channels. So this is an example of one of the recent TSMC inventions integrated into the package, sophisticated power delivery and liquid cooling in case we need to take care of an extra hot chips. Now, it's clear that we will see more powerful chips and more powerful AI ASICs, application-specific integrated circuits, coming in the next years. Managing the extra heat is going to be one of the biggest problems for the electronics moving forward. Already now, we have to go for immersion cooling and have sunk whole racks into tanks of liquid. And the next step is clearly to bring this fluid even closer to the source of this heat. Just think for a moment, how efficient efficient could it be if coolant flew inside the processors? This approach is called embedded cooling, when we bring the liquid to the interior of the silicon, super close to the computing cores that are actually running the job. This is super efficient. This idea goes back to the 90s, when researchers from Stanford University suggested that heat could be removed more effectively if we etch tiny microchannels onto the chip itself. This looked like a potential quick win for cooling, but back then this idea didn't get too much traction. However, with the advancement of manufacturing process, this solution has become more and more practical. You know, one of the problems which brought us to this point now that for a long time, cooling and processing were developed separately. And just a few years ago, researchers at my favorite École Polytechnique Fédérale Lausanne brought this idea to the next level. They designed the electronics and the cooling together from the very beginning. They integrated cooling technology very close to the transistors themselves, right near the channels where electrons flow. Basically, they engineered these three-dimensional cooling channels within the chip itself, right under the active part of the transistors. This is a perfect spot. It's just a few micrometers away from where the heat is actually produced. And the idea is that it prevents heat from spreading throughout the device. So a liquid coolant is pumped through these microchannels, and eventually the cooling liquid flows inside an electronic chip. A small comment here. It sounds really easy in theory, but it's really hard to pull it off in practice without flooding the entire thing. The liquid they used is deionized water, the one that doesn't conduct electricity, of course. And with that, they can handle huge amounts of heat, up to 1,700 watts per square centimeter. This is multiple times heat flux of today's GPUs. According to the paper, it improves the cooling efficiency at least by a factor of 50, and this will help to lighten up those dark parts of silicon we discussed before, eventually boosting the performance, and also we can reduce the amount of energy spent on cooling. Cool! Yes, those GPUs, NVIDIA GPUs that up to 500 to 600 TDP can do without this integrated cooling, but the chips of the future, like wafer scale designs of the future, will definitely benefit from this transistor level integrated cooling. Of course, TSMC is also one of the front runners here. They're working on a similar and quite interesting cooling technology. They call it direct on chip water cooling. Basically, they're creating micro channels directly on the silicon. You see here, these tiny trenches are etched directly into the silicon layer on top of the CPU. They've tested several flavors of this cooling using different techniques, shapes, and liquids, and they found that square pillar trenches perform the best, and with that, they're able to dissipate up to 2.6 kilowatts of heat. Let me know your thoughts on this new technology in the comments. Great technology. I believe we eventually will come to that. I'm pretty sure. The biggest problem here is that we will have to adjust the entire manufacturing process for that. And this will drive up the costs and will make the chips of the future even more expensive. And this technology will be able to cool down some of the hottest and the most powerful chips of the future, like one of the next versions of Cerebras wafer scale engine, for example, which dissipates up to 25,000 watts of heat. If you don't know Cerebras, it's a US-based startup and they are building a large AI accelerator. And they're actually one of the most successful AI chip startups to date who generate more cash than they burn, you know? Their latest wafer scale engine 3 chip that they released this spring is a single gigantic chip of a size of 300 millimeter wafer or a 12 inch wafer. And this single chip is capable of 125 petaflops of AI compute. By area, it's 57 times larger than NVIDIA H100. So you can imagine how hot it can get in there when you have 900,000 AI cores on a single chip. Now try to guess how much heat this one generates and let me know in the comments. Actually, it consumes somewhere from 15,000 up to 25,000 watts. So it's very hot. And Cerebrums themselves say that cooling was one of the greatest challenges they had to solve. And the solution is quite interesting. The wafer floats on top of the heat sink plate. And the heat sink has a labyrinth of microfin channels. And then the water is pumped through these microfins to remove heat from the powered wafer. Although this chip is about 20-something centimeters and very thin, its housing takes a lot of space, and this space is mostly dedicated to cooling. It takes about 1/3 of a standard rack because it includes tubes, pumps, fans, and a heat exchanger, all of which takes a significant amount of space. Then, when we talk of data centers full of NVIDIA GPUs, here we typically use a mixture of air and liquid cooling, combined with special data center layout and airflow management. Did you know that cooling of data centers takes about 40% of the total power? This is huge. And this goes to cooling the air and, of course, cooling the water. And also a vast amount of water is being used for cooling, like hundreds of billions of gallons yearly. Of course, a much more efficient alternative is liquid immersion cooling. And there are many different flavors to it, but the idea is simple. You sink your entire system into some liquid, some non-conductive liquid like dielectric fluid, so that liquid can contact every part of the system. And as the system heats up, the liquid will boil and evaporate. This is a very efficient way of cooling compared to the classical one because it's like 50% more energy efficient and about 61% more area efficient, I mean the area which is taken by the cooling system. That's why all the major servers vendors are now offering solution optimized for the immersion cooling. However, there is a big problem with the immersion cooling because at the moment we are using so-called fast chemicals, which are super toxic. They don't naturally break down. They are contaminating environment and water, and now the industry is moving away from them. By 2025, we should stop the fabrication of the chemicals, and we are researching alternative solutions which are more sustainable because we see how efficient is immersion cooling, and we need some alternative options here. And of course, AI models also can help us out here. For example, Google's DeepMind built an AI model to optimize Google's data center cooling. They took a lot of historical data collected by thousands of sensors like temperature, power, pump speeds, and so on, and they used this data to train a neural network to optimize for power usage effectiveness. They've managed to find some patterns in the workloads and eventually used it to optimize efficiency, and eventually managed to reduce their cooling system power consumption by 40%. This is brilliant. Now to the outlook. In my opinion, on die cooling, what we discussed from EPFL and by TSMC, these technologies are the cooling technologies of the future. But TSMC's innovation pace is incredible, and I'm pretty sure eventually they will be able to pull off something like this. However, there is also a trade-off in that this will also introduce additional challenges for the power delivery. If you don't know, now we are transitioning to the backside power delivery. I have a whole video about that. I will link it below. Check it out later. And this backside power delivery making this cooling challenge even more challenging. Let me know your thoughts in the comments. And while we are talking about hot chips today, the hot chip conference will take place at Stanford University between August 25th to 27th. It's not sponsored. I just want to bring your attention to this conference because it's one of the top conferences in the industry, and you can attend both online and in person. There will be discussions about AI in chip design, all the recent advances in hot chips, and of course about cooling technologies of the future. If you would like to check out the speakers and register, the link is in the description below. And if you enjoyed this video, I would really appreciate if you share this video with your friends, colleagues, or on social media. And if you want to go beyond that, you can support the channel by joining the Patreon. The link is in the description. Thank you so much for watching. I will be back very soon with a new video. Ciao!